Good morning, church. This morning we continue with a series that we began about a month ago on unmasking the things that steal your joy. The concept behind it was that we have little things that we have around us that we permit them to kind of hang around, but they look deceptively innocent, but they are robbing us and they're stealing from us the very peace and joy that we as Christians should have no matter what season we are in. So this morning we're going to look at a big one. One that I can not even scratch the surface of in 20 to 30 minutes. So we're going to look on the subject of suffering. And so as I was preparing my heart to share this word, it reminded me of throughout the pandemic, many commentators on social media have got up on their keyboards and proceeded to kind of put suffering into perspective, you know, talking about the pandemics that have gone, talking about world wars and people that have lived through these things to try and put a perspective on what we are going through right now. But what becomes clear is that suffering is a very subjective thing. You can tell people that, you know, it's not as bad as it used to be. You can tell people, you can show facts of how, you know, yes, we have our liberties curtailed, but it's nothing like the plagues that have gone. It's nothing like living through a world war and seeing death and destruction all around you. It's nothing like it. But if they are broken, lonely, depressed, feeling like life doesn't matter, it really doesn't matter what you say because it's subjective and the pain in their heart is real. So this morning, I don't want us to approach this subject. You know, we tend to get so familiar with things that we approach things going, yeah, I know what this is about. So I want you to kind of leave aside the things you know this morning as we approach God's word. So will you bow your hearts and pray with me? Father God, we come before you and we ask, O Lord, that you will open our eyes and our ears and you will humble our hearts to receive and hear what you have in store for us. Father, for someone who suffered such as you, there hasn't been anyone who has gone through what you have gone through. So, Father, when we study this subject, when we look at God's word to give us knowledge and wisdom and life in these areas that we're struggling in, we can look at no better place than the one who suffered and died for us. So this morning, open our hearts, open our ears, open our eyes. Let us be humble before your word. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. So my scripture this morning is from Paul's letter to the Romans. So Romans chapter 5, Paul writes in verses 3 onwards, "Not only that, but we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us." So Paul is going to tell us that we must rejoice in our suffering. Now, the biggest problem for us is we don't want suffering, let alone to rejoice in our suffering. And because of what has happened in how the Word of God has been taught in this area, we have become a people that think that suffering is something that means something is so wrong, and we resist it and we rebuke it and we bind it and we don't understand its purpose. And so when it comes to the matter of suffering, it's really one of those things that we're uncomfortable to bring before God, because somewhere along the line we feel that God has neglected us and God has not got our best at heart when it comes to these things. So I really want us to kind of look at this idea of suffering this morning. You know, when we talk about what Paul is talking about here is a ripple effect. He's saying that there is going to be, and there is an order, okay? There is an order in which these things will develop in your life. So the very last thing that Paul is talking about in this scripture is hope. Now, in this day and age, hope is something we really, really, really need to have. But the thing is, we have hope today and we don't tomorrow. That kind of hope is not the hope Paul is talking about. In fact, he's telling us that the reason we don't have a hope that is unshakable is because our hope is not built over in the way that God has designed real hope to be birthed. Okay? Let me illustrate it for you. I hate following recipes, right? I hate following recipes. And sometimes this works out really well for me if it doesn't require things to be measured or, you know, weighed. But very often, more often than things work out well, things are disastrous. Because I will not follow the sequence in which things need to be followed. So if it says beat the eggs with the sugar and then add the flour, very often what I do is I just put everything in the bowl at one time. Because I figure they're going to get mixed all together at one point. Does it really matter that they get mixed in different stages and in different ways? Surely we can just put it all in together, and very often my final product is very different to what it's meant to be. A little bit like Nailed It. I'm not sure if you've seen the show. The whole concept is you get this brilliant thing and you're meant to reproduce it, and very often what they reproduce is far cry from what it is meant to be like. And that's a little bit like what my baking is like. Very much because I don't really follow the sequence in which it needs to be followed to produce what it must produce. And what Paul is saying here is, as much as we don't like it, as much as suffering is something that none of us want, it produces endurance. Endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And what he's saying is, this teacher that no one wants is the only way we learn and we develop to be people of substance, people of a hope that cannot be shaken. So let's look at this idea of suffering. You know, one of the biggest barriers to us understanding suffering is that we wonder why a good God would allow suffering, right? And in that, We say, God, you know, we're good. You know, there are bad people out there that good things happen to, but why do good people suffer? You know? And this is very often the question we have. Why do good people suffer? And in that, we make an assumption that we are good. And what we deserve is good things. One of the biggest things that becomes our obstacle to understanding this is that our definition of good is what we consider is good, okay? So what makes me feel good? What looks good? Sometimes we can be very short-sighted, right? I'm not sure if you've seen these ads for spectacles on TV. You know, this guy is looking and there's this absolutely stunning woman walking towards him, and then he puts on his glasses and that's not what's walking towards him, okay? So what it's basically saying is, you know, looks can be really deceiving. What you think you can see is not really how things are. And so sometimes where we are today, I want you to think about a situation in your life that you might be in today that is a really, really difficult situation for you. But if you backtrack, that situation started with something that looked good. And so you made a decision because something looked good, to step into something. And right now, you are in a place of suffering. And your question is, but why can't this change for my good? Okay? And so in our struggle, in our battle, and please understand, I don't have the time today to unpack suffering the way it should be unpacked. I'm not going to talk about the various reasons people suffer, right? But I really want us to understand and wrestle with how Christians suffer and the role of suffering in the life of a Christian. Now, if you're not a Christian this morning, I'll come to that, but I would just ask that you open your heart and just hear what I have to say, okay? So in not being able to understand why God is not taking away our situation in our life, we're actually assuming that taking away that situation is what's good for us. Now, we're the same people that made a decision that this was the very thing that was good for us 10, 15, 5 years ago. We made a decision that this was what was best for us. We chose to engage in it. Now we want it removed because it is no longer what is good for us. My dear brothers and sisters, how you and I see the world and how you and I see good is not how God sees good. You and I, we are finite beings. We can see things that are just around us. We understand things to a very different extent to what God sees as good. Because God is not good. Goodness is in God. So when we say, how can a good God allow suffering, we're assuming that there can be something outside God that's good. But God is good. And so if God is good, everything he permits is good. Is good. Now, the problem is, we cannot understand it. And when we cannot understand it, our biggest grapple is, but surely, what I cannot understand cannot be true. Because ultimately, we have become our own gods. We have become the people that decide what is right and wrong. We have become the people that say, if I don't understand it, it can't be real. John Stuart Mill's grappled with this objection that Christians had, and he said, the whole idea, the biggest problem Christians have is, if God is all suffering and he has all this power, and God is all good, and he is all love. How can these two things coexist? How can these two things coexist? Because a God that is all love will not allow suffering. And a God that is all powerful should be able to end suffering. So how do these things coexist? Either God is not all powerful, or either God is not all good. And that is because we cannot comprehend it. Because we cannot comprehend it. It's very hard to talk on the subject of suffering without going to the book of Job. Because, you know, even today when we talk about suffering, we say that man, he had Job's patience. You know, Job, the oldest book in the Bible, is a book that teaches us about suffering and nothing, and not to a simplistic level, because you know we have become so good at coming up with these simplified responses to people suffering. There, you know, something good will come out of it. And you know, when a person is sitting there in absolute agony, and there is no reason for them to live, and the idea of going through another day is hard. There is nothing worse than hearing someone say something like that. And it makes me very, very upset. You know, I was talking to a brother who had been really, really wrestling with some sickness in his life. And he said to me, I woke up and the pain was so severe, I didn't want to live anymore. I didn't want to live anymore. See, sickness and pain, and whether it's physical pain or psychological pain, can be so intense. It can really change everything. It can change everything. And if we don't understand the dimensions of suffering and how we engage and what God says about it, we become a people that have no space or tolerance for suffering in our life. You know, when I hear some of the things that are taught on the subject of Christians and suffering, I often wonder if you had Paul and Peter and James and John and Matthew and Mark and Luke come in and sit here, and if I were to preach those things to them this day and age, they would laugh in my face. They would laugh in my face. If I said to Paul and to Peter and to Mark and to Matthew, you know, there is no room for suffering in your life. Jesus died so you will not suffer at all. You know, it's something's wrong if you are suffering. You need to claim it. You need to walk in it. You need to, you know, we have gotten so used to making formulas that it saddens me. It saddens me that we have gotten used to making formulas to say, if I do this and this and this and this, I will force God's hand to give me what I want, to do what I think is good. We would never say it. We would never say it. But we are manipulating or trying to manipulate God to give us what we want. He is not a small God. He is not a God that you appease with a fruit basket and an offering in some temple out there. That you say, if I bring you this, you give me that. That God is my equal. At worst, he's my lackey. He's a God that does things that I want him to do. A God that I can understand, a God that I can control, is no God at all. He's my equal. When we pray and we speak these things, you know, it's sad, I've been there. So when I was a new Christian, I remember thinking that if I said things a certain way, and if I learned to pray in a certain way, and if I learned to walk in a certain way, God would have no choice but to do these things for me. And as I learned and I walked in Him, as I got to know, and I continue to learn, and I continue to be humbled at the immensity of the God that we serve, I realize how foolish I was to think that I would manipulate, that I would, and it is that when we think we will do something to get something we want, it is a transactional relationship, and that's all we want from it. And see, that's why the book of Job is so very relevant to us. Because the question that comes when suffering comes is the very thing that Satan brings to God at the start of the book. So in Job chapter 1, God is in the heavens and Satan comes before him. And God says to Satan, "Have you seen my servant Job?" And Satan says, and I want you to listen carefully. Satan says, "Does Job have no reason to praise you? You have put a hedge of protection around him. You have blessed him with everything. If you take away the things you've given Job, he will curse you." Now, the reason I want you to pay attention to this is this. Satan's claim here is that Job loves you because of what he can get from you. Job loves you because you give him good things. I want you to take stock for a minute. Could Satan say the same about his church today? Could Satan say the same about his church today? When I hear some of the things that are shared, and when I hear some of the messages that are preached about how this is all there is to it, you would think that we were people that this is all there was. And I am not minimizing suffering. I am not. But you see, if we don't fully understand the hope that we have, then we won't endure suffering, and we won't develop character, and we won't have a hope. So Job say, sorry, Satan says to God, Job loves you because of what he has. And God says, if you take away everything he has, he will still love me. My question this morning, as we think about suffering, is that. Because sometimes suffering is the things that we have loved in our life have been taken away. And we wonder whether God still loves us. You see, Job's response to that, when all around him, when his children had passed away, when his livestock and his all his wealth was gone, Job's response to that was, naked I came, naked I will go. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Are we a people that when everything we have loved has been taken away and our hearts are breaking? Because this is not just things, these are people. And it is hard to say goodbye to the people that you love. If you have lived long enough, my brothers and sisters, you have suffered. You have watched the people around you suffer. You have buried a loved one. And when you are there, and your heart is breaking and you're in pain, can you still bless the Lord and know that he loves you? Because that's what we see in Job's life. And the second thing that happens is Satan says, it's not just the things, it's not just the people, it's about health. You see, to some of us, health is such an idol. You know, if I don't have health, it changes everything. And the hard thing is, health can actually be something that it's really hard to have a sound mind when your body is plagued with illness. And I'm not minimizing it, it's really hard. Because the relationship between a physical illness and a sound mind is a very complex one. And an unsound mind, a mental health issue, and a physical well-being is also a very complex one. It's not independent of each other. In fact, they feed into each other. If you are so mentally unwell, you are going to start to feel physically unwell. You're going to start to see manifestations of that mental health issue in your physical being. If you are so physically unwell, it is so hard to be at peace and to be joyful, you are going to start to see manifestations of the physical health issue in your mental health. And this is exactly where Job is. His entire body is plagued with boils. And he takes a clay pot and he starts scraping these boils. And a lot of people come around him with a lot of advice. And if you have suffered to whatever extent, you know these people. And if you're a better person than me, you've probably not had to fight back or resist the urge to give them a piece of your mind when they give you a piece of theirs. Because there is nothing worse than those simplistic rationalizings when you are in pain. So these people come to Job. So first, his wife, you know, curse the Lord and die. It's better to die than to live. Then his friends, Eliphaz, you must have sinned. You must have done something to bring this suffering upon you. Now, I don't want to minimize this, right? Because the reason we have suffering, the reason we have sickness is because of sin. So with the fall of man, everything is broken, right? The whole world is broken. All of creation has degenerated, including the human condition, including the human form. And all of this is waiting for the coming restoration of that will come when our King comes again. So we're not waiting to go up in the ether into some formless heaven where we fly and we play harps. We are waiting for a new heaven and a new earth to be established, and we will have glorified bodies when we will rule and reign with Him, our King. That is the ultimate destination for the Christian. So when Job is sitting there and he's suffering, he's got all these friends coming up with all these ideas about what he should do. And Job cries out to the Lord. He cries out to the Lord. And the reason I really want to share this with you is there's 37 chapters of this conversation in the book of Job. One of the first things we do as Christians when suffering comes is that we take it to the Lord. And after that, we get tired of taking it to Him because we think God is not listening. We think God doesn't love us. Because if God doesn't give me good things, then He must not love me. Because in my here and now, this seems to be the only thing that is good. Don't forget, God doesn't see the way I see. I am short-sighted. I am nearsighted. God is eternal. God is eternal. And Job cries out to the Lord. 37 chapters of just honest emotion going to the Lord. Just conversation that is so very honest. You know, and we learn. And we learn God doesn't want our pat prayers. God doesn't want some, high and lifted up. He wants us to fall on our knees and be real with Him. He wants us to cry out and be real with Him. He wants us to come to Him. Because you see, if the Lord is permitting something, then He alone has the solution. He alone has the why. He alone has the what is the outcome. As Job goes to Him, one of the things he says, and I want to say this because we've been there. He says, I wish I had never been born. He says, I wish I had never been born. And maybe in your pain, in your suffering, you have been in those places where you wished that you had never been born. If that is the case, then you are in the right place today. Because see, Job took it to the Lord. And the Lord spoke to Job. In chapter 38, the Lord speaks to Job. What you don't see is any reasoning or any answers to any of the questions Job put to the Lord. You see, even as the book ends, in Job chapter 41, and all things in Job's life have been restored much more than what he had at the start of his suffering. When all things had been given back to him more than, it says the latter days of Job's life were greater than the former ones. When all that had happened, he still didn't have the why. He still didn't have the why. God never says why. But you see, you and I, we know the why today. Because thousands of years later, you and I are studying the life of Job. And we are learning what it means as a Christian when suffering comes our way. We are learning what we do when Christians suffer. You see, try telling that to someone thousands and thousands of years later. People are going to be reading this book. You're going to be like, just take away my pain. Because this is the sight of what I see. Because I am selfish and I want my redemption. But oh, if we would step outside ourselves for a moment to see God's grand plan for you and I. You see, if you and I were God, when Joseph was betrayed by his brothers and thrown in a pit, and you and I had to find a solution, we would have gone and rescued him from the pit. When Joseph was sold as a slave, the first case of human trafficking we see. You know, it's something that is so near to my heart. You know, when people are sold into slavery and they are objectified, and their mere value is considered something that someone else can gain from. The very case of human trafficking in the life of Joseph, he is sold as a slave. You and I, if we were God, what's our solution? Let's go redeem Joseph. When he then goes to Potiphar's house and everything goes well, things look good, but then he's in prison. Because at 18, when Potiphar's wife comes onto him, he rejects her advances. And you and I, what justice would we bring? I want you and me to just think for a moment. If you had to find a solution into Joseph's life at that point in time, Joseph has just been wrongfully accused. What is the justice you and I want? Bring up Potiphar's wife. She has lied. Not only has she committed adultery, she has lied. And this innocent boy is in jail. That's the justice we want. We would have spared Joseph the pit. We would have spared Joseph the slave traders. We would have spared Joseph the prison cell. We would have spared Joseph. And in all of that, we would have deprived Joseph of becoming prime minister of Egypt. We would have deprived Joseph of bringing all the people into that one place because of the famine, and because that was the only land that had food, because he had interpreted the dreams. All of Israel, all the nations, neighboring nations, come under this great power, paving the way for the Exodus. Paving the way for God's people to go, and for the Red Sea to part, and for people to know the glory of God. To know the glory of God. So that this God that was just the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, by the time the Exodus had happened, by the time the spies were sent to Canaan, there is a prostitute by the name of Rahab who says, "We have heard of your God." You and I, had we been God in Joseph's life, would have picked a very different solution at each one of those points. What about David? When David had to face Goliath, would we let him go? When David had slain Goliath and Saul was tormenting him and trying to kill him, would we have brought Saul out, chastised Saul, raised David before time? Would we have taken David out of those caves when he was hiding and said, "You are the rightful king. You have been anointed. Let me get rid of Saul. Put aside Saul. Let me raise you up." And in doing that, we would have deprived Israel of the greatest king, the man after God's own heart, because he knew caves and trying to, you know, persecution when he didn't deserve it. What about Esther? You know, if you and I had to make a decision on where Esther was placed, and you and I had to orchestrate the salvation of a people, we would not send a little girl there. You would not send a little girl and then place her and wed her to a king, a pagan king, who is then going to decree genocide of her people. You and I would not work it out that way. You and I would spare Esther the tension. You and I would spare Esther all of that hardship. What about Jesus? What about Jesus? Imagine you and I walking with him. We see blind, see. We see two fish and five loaves feed 5,000 men. We see people who can't walk. We see lepers being healed. We see what God is capable of, even as God becomes veiled in flesh. And then is the cross. What would you and I do if we were God and our son was hanging on the cross? And the very things that your hand had crafted and you had breathed life into stood there in arrogance and mocked at the very creator, the very creator that allowed you to breathe so you could speak those words. You sat there and you watched these people mocking your son. You watch them think that these three nails are holding him to a cursed tree. What would you and I as God do? Bring him down from the cross, oh man. Spare the son. These people can be saved in another way. Let's send some people out. Let's develop a strategy. Let's do it another way. And what about you? What is your situation that you are crying out to God for? What is your situation that God does not seem to take away? And so like Job, you're crying out to God and you're saying, God, remove this, because in yours and my situation, as we sit and we look, this seems to be the only solution. And in taking that away, what would you be missing out from? What would I be missing out from? See, Paul, writing to the Corinthians, says, therefore, we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away. Your inner self is being renewed day by day, for our light and momentary affliction is producing for us an eternal glory that is far beyond comparison. And so we fix our eyes on what is not seen. For what is seen is temporary. But what is unseen is eternal. When Paul talks about light and momentary affliction, we know that Paul had a thorn in his flesh, a physical ailment, most presume, that even though he prayed to the Lord to take it away, it was never taken away. And the Lord's answer to Paul was, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. Paul suffered till the day he died. And he died for Christ. And he calls that a light and momentary affliction in light of the eternal glory that is to come. My brothers and sisters, yours and my ways are not his ways. When you and I look at our situation and we try to find the solution, what we're really saying to God is, I think this is what's best for me. And could it be that God is allowing suffering in the life of the Christian for our redemption? For our sanctification, for our perfection, for the edification of the saints. For the edification of the saints. Because you see, the allegation that Satan brought against Job is really the crux of the story. It is the crux of the story. If everything you and I enjoy are taken away, would we still love him? Would we still love him? Because if we don't, then we love him because he gives us things. And what God is creating in us is the same kind of love that he had for us. What did you and I bring to the equation when Christ died for us? What was in it for him? What was in it for him? Us. Just us. That was it. We brought nothing to the equation. We bring nothing to the equation. Us. Is he enough for us? When everything else is taken away and everything is moved, can we too say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. For in him are all things, and all things are for him, for his glory. For, you know, Paul understood, he understood that whatever happened here, there was good. There was good, not good as man sees it, good as God sees it, an eternal good, not a short-sighted good, not a good that you see blurry without your glasses, and then one day when we are glorified, we will look at it and it'll make sense. We an eternal good. Paul says, all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. We quote that scripture day in, day out, but do we believe it? That all things, that suffering, that persecution, that hardship work together for your and my good. Because in that moment, what is being tested and tried is, do you still love him when everything else is taken away? Is God enough? Because you were enough for him. You were enough for him. Is God enough for you? What is being perfected is our love. What is being purified is us. What is being changed is a generation. We will never see the impact of our faith. Job had no idea that today you and I would read this and take heart in our suffering, knowing that God will come through, that God is faithful, that he will come through. So this morning, as I close, I really want to encourage you. I really want to encourage you. Maybe you've really battled with whatever it is that you are suffering with. And you see, for the Christian, for anyone, suffering is inevitable. But for the Christian, suffering is not the end. Your suffering is not in vain. For the Christian, your suffering is bringing about something glorious, something eternal, something for your good, because God's ways are not your ways. He doesn't see things the way you do. The cross of Jesus Christ is proof of that. And if God did not move when his son stood there and said, oh my God, why have you forsaken me? Because this was the best way. And this was for our good. And we can't understand that. Then we must stand humbled when we don't understand that now. We must stand humbled and not try to give pat answers and simplify things when we don't understand why we're going through what we're going through now. We must stand humbled because God is God and he is good. He is good. And what he is building in us is something that is eternal. Not that something just for this world. Something that will live beyond what we can see or understand. So we can say, like Paul, not only that we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. The hope of Jesus Christ may be birthed in yours and my heart through our hardship. Through our suffering, may we be people of character, of godly character, not a pretense, not a behavioral modification, but character that has been forged in the furnace of suffering, character that can only be taught by the teacher that none of us want. And may you and I be a people of a hope that is beyond our circumstance, beyond our situation. That when we look at the world and everything that is happening in the world, May we be a people that are not shaken, because the hope that we have, the Holy Spirit within us, it has been poured into our hearts so that we can be a light in a dying world, because we know we were created for more. We were created for more. I would like to pray with you this morning before I close. If you will close your eyes. And just for a minute, I want you to think about whatever it is that you are in at the moment. What is your situation? What is your pain? What is your suffering? What is your hardship? In the Gospel of John, the Pharisees asked Jesus about a man born blind, and they say, why is this man born blind? Is it because he sinned? Is it because his parents sinned? And God's answer, Jesus' answer, is for the glory of God. And he heals the man. I'm not saying this morning that your suffering is forever and it's not going to be taken away. Because God is a God who heals. God is a God who restores. God is a God of miracles. But I am saying that, like Job, when Satan comes and says, these people only love you because you do that, is it true that even if those things that we so desire never happen in our life, would we still love him? Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, when faced with the loss of life, when faced with no hope in the physical world, would we still say, our God is able, but even if he does not, he is still God. He is still God, and I will still worship him. And I will still sing of his love. You see, whatever it is you are going through, Christian, whatever it is, God may choose to heal in a moment. He may take many years. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. Thank goodness for that. But I don't want to leave you. I don't want to leave you with just that. I want you to know that on that cross, God turned his face away from his son, so that when you suffer, he would come near and be with you. And in your suffering, be your very strength, be your very grace, and in you, make you more like his eternal son. So this morning, I really pray that whatever it is that you are seeking the Lord for, that you will be able to pray a bold prayer this morning. That whether God does or does not, he is able, but even if he does or does not, I want you to be able to say and pray a bold prayer this morning. That I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises will always be on my lips. Whether he changes your situation or not, whether he brings healing or not, whether that breakthrough comes or not, whether it takes many years, whether I have to endure, whatever happens, God is still for my good. I want you to say it aloud. God is for my good. God is for my good. God is for my good. Not the way I see it, the way he sees it. Not my ways, but his ways, because he is God over all. God is for your good. And so we can say, even as Paul did, that even though this body is perishing and outwardly wasting, and though it seems like things are not happening day by day, on the inside, God is creating, God is building, God is purifying. And so we fix our eyes on what we cannot see, not what we can see, because those things are eternal, and what I can see is momentary. I want to encourage you this morning, if you have prayed that bold prayer, then stand and worship the Lord this morning. This morning, as we close the service, we're going to sing Graves to Gardens, and I want you to stand, and I want you to sing like you've never sung before. I want you to look your sickness in the face. I want you to look your pain in the face. I want you to look your situation in the face, and then I want you to lift your eyes to the cross. I want you to lift your eyes to the cross, because he can make gardens out of graves. He can make a path in the wilderness. He is the way maker. He is the promise keeper. He is the light in the darkness. And he is doing something eternal in his life, because God is for your good, not for your temporary good, for your eternal good. So rejoice, saints, this morning. Rejoice. Let the song resonate in your heart. Sing, dance, lift up your hands, for there is nothing that can touch you, and you know God is for your good. God bless you this morning. God bless you.